Welcome. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord.
Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.
Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, O Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy upon the contemplation of those mighty acts whereby you have given us life and immortality, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. If it is the Lord God who helps me, who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
I invite you now to lift up whatever green or branchy thing you have with you. It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. On this day, he entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed as King of Kings by those who spread their garments and branches of palm along his way. Let these branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns in glory with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ, amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and also share in his resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When Jesus and his disciples had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Good morning. I hope that you have your palms with you or some sort of branch or long grass that you waved around today. Please do not hit your siblings or annoy your animals with these branches. They are not intended to be an invitation into temptation. They're supposed to help us imagine what it was like as if we were there that wild day when Jesus marched into town, the King of Israel entering the city gates. Did you all throw your coats on the floor during glory, laud, and honor? These strange times call for new practices and temporary ways of being church. But it wouldn't really be Palm Sunday if you didn't hear me whine for yet another year that we didn't have a donkey in our procession, right? No donkey at St. Matthew's today. There's always hope for next year, though. And hey, if you've never made a palm cross, maybe this is the year that you want to learn how to do it. For this Sunday has two parts to it: the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which we already heard, and the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, which we will hear near the end of the Eucharist. This is the third year that we're trying out the chanted Passion Gospel on Palm Sunday, and the second year that we are telling that story after communion using an experimental liturgy. This year, you will be able to participate in the Passion narrative as we have printed it for you in the bulletin. You get to play the part of the crowd. And that really has me thinking about the crowd in the gospel that we just read and what we have in common with that crowd. The crowd was electric with hope and fear. They were very much looking for a savior. They were excited about seeing Jesus, hoping that he was the famed king who would bring peace at last. They all knew how the story would go. It's laid out in Zechariah's prophecy. When the Prince of Peace comes, the poetic language states that he will be riding in humility and also riding triumphantly on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Matthew's author is hypersensitive to the Old Testament prophecies, and so he writes the gospel covering all his bases when he describes Jesus actually riding on both animals. It sounds a little awkward, but given a big enough pile of cloaks, we can make the image work. Or Jesus doesn't really have to be riding on both at the same time. It could be that both are there to convey important symbolism in the story. Jesus comes into the city in the way that Israel expected its king to arrive, the king who is also God. So much is going on in the hearts of those in the crowd, and I think that that's true for us today. Even though we are not able to be in a physical crowd, there are emotions swirling. We've seen usual displays of hope and resilience by now, with our daily pots and pans clanging and church bells ringing, with sidewalk chalk on our walkways and rainbows and flags displayed at our houses. We are present in this moment of global pandemic crisis, even though this isn't our normal way of being a crowd. And we're paying particular attention to our government these days, just like they had to do. Our governor couldn't be more different in character from the Roman governor in this gospel. Thanks be to God for that grace in our own time. But like the gospel, this is a precarious moment, and we are alert and aware that the decisions our political leaders make directly affect our well-being and the well-being of the individuals in our families, but also the well-being of the incarcerated, the vulnerable, the endangered, and the poor. So like in the gospel, we are living in a time of unrest, particularly economic unrest, which threatens our stability. It is a dangerous time for us too. People are dying, and some of the deaths were preventable. We've seen self-preservation rear its ugly head all too often in the last few weeks. This happens when we let fear control us. And so it was in an environment not totally dissimilar from ours that Jesus makes his move. The stunt that he pulled on the donkey is how he got into trouble with Rome. Rome was an oppressive regime. It was concerned with putting down any and all threats to its power. Pax Romana tells us it is all about keeping peace by keeping the emperor in charge. Compare that with the peace of Christ. That peace looks like Jesus giving up his life for the love of the world. Now, the stunt on the donkey doesn't cost Jesus his life, but it does cost him his freedom. People knew the story that had been passed down from generation to generation, that someday the Messiah would enter Jerusalem through a certain gate in the city, and that he would be riding a donkey. When this king chosen by God came, they would be free. So when the message spread that something was happening, everyone was on high alert. When the whispers about a king coming to take down the empire spread, they gathered, ready to see it all unfold. Nobody takes on Rome and lives. At the same time, the Roman army began preparations for battle. The soldiers put on their armor. The chariots were rolled out and fitted with horses. Commanders lined up the troops and began the march. Jesus prepared as well. He calls for a donkey and its foal. The disciples took off their coats and put them on the animals, and Jesus was seated. As he made his way up to the city gates, the rumors spread like wildfire through the chorus of souls who were about to make history. They climbed the trees and cut down branches off of the palms which belonged to the emperor himself. They waved them wildly. They threw down their coats and looked to the beautiful gate. As he approached, they gave him a king's welcome, the branches and the coats on the ground symbolizing a military victory, even before the conflict began. When Jesus rode in on that donkey, there was no dismissing the prophecies. God's king had come, and so they shouted with all their might for God's king to save them. Finally, the days of King David had returned. Finally, God was going to clean house. Like Pharaoh's army was drowned in the Red Sea, and all of the chariots with it. Finally, God's king has come to save them from their oppressors. And so with all their might, they greeted Jesus with shouts of Hosanna, which means, oh, save us. Revolution was in the air. As Jesus processed into Jerusalem, he fulfilled the prophecies and made a mockery of the empire, fulfilled the scriptures by arriving as they foretold, and challenged them by not overthrowing the oppressor of God's people, but death itself. They expected a military king and got a martyr instead. They thought that God's vengeance would rain down, but God's love prevailed that day. We wave our palm branches and mark this day with shouts for God to save us as well. But perhaps our assumptions about God's agenda also need to be challenged. The crowd didn't get what they wanted out of Jesus. A few days later, they are the ones calling for his crucifixion. This year, more than other years, I think it's important for us to pay attention to the crowd. This year, more than other years, maybe you will see how Pilate manipulates them so cruelly, how they are coerced into becoming the voice who chooses Barabbas over Jesus. This gospel exposes so many false human narratives. Perhaps we're living in a time ripe for seeing more clearly. For the cross is the truth about this world and the truth about God. All of those other stories we generate to protect our privilege and pride are called into question during Holy Week. And I hope we can be the better for walking this way these next holy days. For I am more sure than I've ever been that I need the suffering Jesus offered to us in such great humility today. And by that, I don't mean that I need Jesus to suffer. I mean that Jesus' suffering shows us something very real about God's presence with us and God's love for us. The hope that I see in this day is that we might see anew in this story the horrors that humans will always allow illustrated plainly, and how God just does it differently. Perhaps it's an opportunity for us to lay down our rituals and narratives where self-protection is the highest ideal, and instead take our gaze to the cross, where we see God's vision for a world transformed. May it be so.
Amen. Today we lift up our prayers to God with the words, God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For our Bishop Terry and for all members of your church, unite us in our worship of you and our pursuit of your callings. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our Mayor Greg, our Governor Andy, and our President Donald, and for all in positions of authority, give them wisdom, mercy, and courage. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For physicians, nurses, techs, and all others who minister to the sick, grant them protection, wisdom, and skill. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the sick and those who fear sickness, for everyone who has contracted the coronavirus, we pray for healing and wholeness. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For everyone who is lonely and isolated, gather our community together. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For everyone on our pastoral prayer list, are there others? God, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
For those who have died, for Brian Joseph Grigsby, Andrew Fletcher Kyle, and John Custis Fletcher, are there others? God, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Almighty God, to whom our needs are known before we ask, help us to ask only what accords with your will, and those good things which we dare not or in our blindness cannot ask, grant us for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace.
Peace. All right. So I think that we had some birthdays since last week and some anniversaries. So I'll start with the anniversary prayer, then please join me on the birthday prayer. Oh God, send your blessing upon those who have a wedding anniversary, that they may so love, honor, and cherish each other in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world, brought forth all creatures of the earth, and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we shout with joy. Honor are yours, Creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You called the people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us, a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his friends, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection, and ascension, longing for Christ coming in glory and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroyed our death.
Rising, you restored our life.
Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body of blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with all your people into the joy of our true eternal home. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise.
Blessed are you, now and forever. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Jesus, my Savior, I ask you to come into my heart and fill me with your love. Although I cannot physically join with others to celebrate the Eucharist today, I desire to offer my thanksgivings and prayers in union with all who worship with you, wherever they may be. And although I cannot receive you now sacramentally in the bread and wine of Holy Communion, still I desire to receive your body and blood spiritually and feed on your love, that I may be united with you and with all your people in one communion and fellowship, your mystical body, the Church, now and evermore. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What will you give me if I betray him to you?"
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment, he began to look for an opportunity to betray Jesus. On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying,
"Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
He said,
"Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'"
So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me."
And they became greatly distressed, and began to say to him, one after another,
"Surely not I, Lord."
He answered,
"The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
Judas, who betrayed him, said,
"Surely not I, Rabbi."
He replied,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said,
"Take, eat, this is my body."
Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
shall become deserters because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you.
Jesus said to him,
Truly I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me three times.
Peter said to him,
Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
And so said all the disciples. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
Sit here while I go over there and pray.
He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them,
I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me.
And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed,
My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want.
Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
So could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray, that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Again he went away for the second time and prayed,
My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, Your will be done.
Again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed unto the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him.
At once he came up to Jesus and said,
Greetings, Rabbi,
and kissed him. Jesus said to him,
Friend, do what you are here to do.
Then they came and laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. Suddenly, one of those with Jesus put his hand on the sword, drew it, struck the high slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
"Put your sword back into its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say it must happen in this way?"
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me, as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple preaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place so that the scriptures of the prophets may be fulfilled."
Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas the high priest, in whose house the scribes and elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus, so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last two came forward and said,
"This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.'"
The high priest stood up and said,
"Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?"
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
"I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God."
Jesus said to him,
"You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?"
They answered,
"He deserves death."
Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying,
"Prophesy to us, you Messiah, who is it that struck you?"
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said,
"You also were with Jesus the Galilean."
But he denied it before all of them, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders,
"This man was with Jesus of Nazareth."
Again he denied it with an oath,
"I do not know the man."
After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
"Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you.
Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath.
I do not know the man.
At that moment the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring about his death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the high priests and the elders. He said,
I have sinned by betraying innocent blood.
But they said,
what is that to us? See to it yourself.
Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said,
it is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money.
After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the Field of Blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of the one on whom a price had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus said,
you say so.
But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him,
do you hear how many accusations they make against you?
But he gave him no answer, not even a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them,
whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus, Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him,
have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him.
Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
which one of the two do you want me to release for you?
And they said,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?
All of them said,
let him be crucified.
Then he asked,
why, what evil has he done?
But they shouted all the more,
let him be crucified.
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves.
Then the people as a whole answered,
His blood be on us and on our children.
So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews!
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head they put the charge against him, which read, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to. For he said, I am God's son.
The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice,
Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani.
That is,
my God, why have you forsaken me?
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
This man is calling for Elijah.
At once one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the other said,
Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were open, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keep watching over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
Many women were also there, looking on from a distance. They had followed Jesus from Galilee and had provided for him. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive. After 3 days, I will rise again. Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people, 'He has been raised from the dead.' And the last deception would be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go make it as secure as you can." So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone.